Yes, please. So what going we are going to start with, it's a Python. Python is what? It's a kind of programming language. It's a kind of high-level language. It's a kind of object-oriented programming language. It's a kind of general-purpose programming language. And it's a kind of clear cross-platform programming language. Cross-platform means what? We can work with the Python, whether it's in Windows or it's in Linux. So it can be applicable for any particular platform. So it's not a platform specific. And this Python was developed by he was the developer of Python. Python was developed by Godot van Rossum. So if I need to define like what exactly the Python is, in simple language we can say it's a kind of high level, object-oriented, general-purpose, cross-platform programming language. General-purpose means what? We can do any kind of programming, whether it's a Windows programming. Windows programming means what? I need to develop the application that will run for the individual systems only. Web application means we are talking about the websites. If I need to perform the scientific calculations over there, for there is a different purpose for the different Python is over there. So it's a kind of general purpose programming language. It's a kind of object oriented programming language. Object oriented programming language means what? It based on the class and object. Every time we need to define the class, we need to define the objects that we need to understand. And obviously it's a kind of high level language. Can you tell me one thing, like when the Python get developed? Okay, my question will be like, it's a Java is older or the Python is older?
Java
is older, that's the good answer. But it's not exactly like that. This Python was developed in 94. Your Java was developed in 95. This Python was developed in 1994. Your Java was developed in 1995. So Python is the older language. It's even, we can say it's the oldest language. The development in Python was started in 80s. Now you can tell me one thing, like even the Python was developed in 1994. It's older than Java. Java was released in 95. .NET was released in 99. It was the beta release. The actual release was released in 2003. And this Python was developed in 1994. Then why the people are trying to work with the Python from last 2 or 3 years? Like earlier, like in 2010, in 12, like as such there was no Python in the market and all. But from last 3 to 4 years, the people are trying to use the Python. So now you can ask me the question, like it was developed in the first release of the Python comes in the market in 1994 and it's 2019. Why now people are moving towards the Python? Why not earlier? It's a good question exactly. From this particular point of view, you can understand what exactly the strength of the Python. See, if I am talking about the current industry scenario, earlier the project was in Java, earlier the project was in .NET. All the companies, they were working with the Java, working with the .NET, now they are moving towards the Python. What is the reason behind that? What I think, it's my personal opinion might be, but what I think the great advantage of the Python is, it's a library. The Python having the great advantage, it's a library. It's a huge library. Huge library means what? For every purpose in the Python having the different library. If I need to go for the Windows programming, there is a different library. If I need to go for the web programming, there is a different library. If I need to go for the scientific work, it's a different library. if I need to go for the astrology, it's a different library is there. If I need to go for the geoscience, it's a different library is there. What I'm trying to say, for each and everything in the Python having the different library, you don't need to write the code and all. Like in Java and .NET, what exactly is there? It's only collection of classes are there. In the classes, the generic functions are there. And normally, we just apply the generic function, and by the applications of the generic function, we can mix the application, and that application we can apply. But in Python, you don't need to mix the application. It's already there. What exactly we need to do? What exactly we need to do? We just need to use the library. We just need to use the library. We just need to use the library. For the scientific purpose, we are having the NumPy. We are having the SciPy. We are having the NumPy. We are having the SciPy. For the astrology, we are having the AstroPy. What I'm trying to say in the Python, the good thing is, for every purpose, we are having the different set of libraries is there. So as a Python developer, you don't need to write the code for each and everything. What exactly you need to learn about, you just need to learn how to use the library. In that particular library, what are the components over there, what are the methods over there, and how we can apply that. That's it. That's the great thing about the Python. And now you can ask me the question, even though Python was developed in 94, but still, from last 3 to 4 years, now people are using the Python. What about the middle period? In the middle, the developer of the Python and the team of the team was involved with the development of the library the entire life. Like the first release one in 94. Work in the Python was get started in 85 around. The unofficial version of the Python was released in 92. So from 85 to this 19, in the complete time span of time, they were just involved with the development of the library in the Python. So the Python having the great advantage over other languages, having great set of libraries there. For each and every purpose, you can just use the library. And one important thing, it's not only the library. The another good thing is that it's an open source. It's an open source. It's an open source. You don't need to purchase the license and all. If you are working with the .NET, if you are working with the Java, in Java again for the some components and all, for the higher level you need to do something. Like in .NET again, you need to purchase the license and all. The good thing about the Python is you don't need to purchase the license and all. It's an open source. Other than this, the good thing about the Python is simple syntax. We don't need to follow the syntax badly. Like in C, in C++, in Java, every time you need to follow the syntax. You need to follow the rules and regulations of the syntax and all. You need to use the open braces, close braces, you need to use the semicolon. But in Python, it's really simple. You don't need to apply the semicolon. You don't need to use the braces and all. So that's the good thing about the Python. So if now I need to conclude what exactly the Python is, my answer will be Python is a kind of high-level, object-oriented, general-purpose, cross-platform, open-source, simple programming language. Developed by Godeb and Rossum in 94. The great advantage of the Python is it's a huge library is there. For each and every purpose, for each and every work, there is a different library. For the Windows application, there is a different library is there. For the web, again, we are having the different library. For the scientific calculation, for the astrology, for the geoscience, for everything, we are having a different set of library is there. Remember, one important thing, like the another good thing about the Python is, like, why this name Python is there? What is the name is Python? When we consider the name of the Python, normally we think about the danger snack. It's not like that. The name of the Python was, see, in early 70s in USA, there was the comedy circus, comedy serial was there. The name of the serial was Monty Python's Flying Circus. Monty Python's Flying Circus. This was the name of that particular serial. And the author was very fond to this particular serial. And from this particular serial, the name Python is there. In fact, Python is not like it's a dangerous snack. It's not like that. The name Python came from this particular word. It's in the 70s, there was a serial called Monty's Python Flying Circus. From this particular, this Python term comes in the picture. Now, for Python, initially, as a programmer, what we need to do, like our today agenda is just to install the Python, how to install the Python, how to start the work, installation. After that, we will start the work, and we will try to learn the basic syntax of the Python, like how to use the if statement, how to apply the for loop, how to apply the while loop. So we will just go for the initial level, like how to apply the input, how to use the print and all. And after that, we will go with the next topic and all. So first of all, what we need to do, we need to install the Python. How to install the Python? I'm just going to start with the browser. I'm simply writing Python download. Python download. There is a website called Download Python, python.org is there. And these are the different versions we can apply for. Like download the latest version of the Python. So we are just going to start with download Python 3.7.4. This one is the latest release, 3.7.4. This was released in July 8, 2019. You can go for the specific Python, like if you are looking for the Mac operating system, if you are looking for the Unix operating system or Linux, if you are looking for the Windows operating systems. For the Python, what we can do, initially we will start with the core Python, like we will start with the Python softwares only. And some other framework is also there, like we are having the called Anaconda. It's again the Python IDE that we can start with, but we will go for this Anaconda and all later on. Initially, we are just going to start with the Python. I'm just going to click on this. It will get installed. Yeah, I just installed the wrong one, like 32-bit that I need to consider. It should be 64-bit, otherwise further it create the problem for me. So I'm just going to start with Windows and I'm looking for executable installer, Windows x86-64. I'm going to just use this. At the time of installation, we need to check whether it's a 32-bit or 64-bit. Further, it can be create the problem for you. So initially, if your system is of 64-bit, just install the 64-bit Python. If your system is of 32-bit, just install 32-bit Python.
But did you download the executive executable installer?
Yeah, you can download like anyone, like embedded or executable. Executable is fine. It's just you need to click next, next,
okay.
next, finish it, will get installed.
Yeah.
It's a 64-bit. Select upgrade now to keep your current settings and all. Remember, Python is the interpreted language. It's not a compiled one. Python is the interpreted language. Remember, any language that will be compiled, create the exe file. This is the symbol, whether it's a compiled or interpreted. If it's compiled, it will create the exe file. If it's not compiled, it will create some other files. So initially we just need to install the Python. At the time of installation, we need to take care of what it's 32-bit or 64-bit, what Python we are installing. Now, what I'm going to do, I need to open the Python. So I'm just going to write IDLE. IDLE is the basically it's a Python integrated development environment. So I'm just going to write IDLE, integrated development environment. I'm just going to start with. Now it will open the environment for you. It will open the environment for you. Now this is the environment where we need to write the Python program. This is your version of Python, it's 3.7.4. Now what I need to do, see, the first thing, I want to display something like hello world. This is the first applications normally in any language. And if I need to display the hello world over there, this is the first program. Remember, everything we need to write in a small, every time. Print is the function to display. Print is the function to display. I am writing, hi, good morning. That's it. We are getting the answer. We don't need to use the main method. We don't need to import the things. We don't need to include the header files. You don't need to do anything. This is how you can use the Python over there. And this particular mode is known as immediate mode. Like, suppose I want to display the sum of two values. I'm writing A is equal to 20, B is equal to 30, C is equal to A plus B. I'm writing print C. Now the answer is ready. This is how easy the Python is. Suppose I want to go for the input. I'm writing A is equal to int, input, enter, number. Now remember, input is basically used for the input. And every time when you input the value, by default it will be of string type. So we need to convert the string into the integer. So we are using A is equal to int, input, enter, number. Enter number, I'm giving 456. Now I need to display the number, print. The number is comma, I'm using A. And we are getting the answer, the number is 456. So this is what, this is your immediate mode. Immediate mode means what? You can write down the program over here. And we are having the script mode also. Script mode means what? We are having the script mode. One is the immediate mode. One is immediate mode. Immediate mode means here you can write the things and all and you will get the output. And the second one is the script mode. How we can work with the script mode? I'm just going to use file, new file. It will open the notepad kind of window is there, but it's not a notepad. It's not a notepad. Now, this is the comment line we can use. This is the single line comment we can use in the Python. I'm writing first program in Python. A is equal to int, input. I'm writing enter, number. Again, we are using A is equal to B is equal to int, input, enter, number. Again, I am writing C is equal to A plus B. I am writing print. The sum is comma C. It will display like this. Now what I need to do, I run this program. I am just going to click on this, run. Run module, F5. Or we can use the F5. You need to save the file. I am going to save the file. By default, it will get saved in this location. And the extension will be .py. I'm just writing a.py. It's a Python file. The extension will be .py. Enter number. Enter number. The sum is 999. So either we can write the program over here. This is called a script mode. Sorry, it's called immediate mode. Or we can write the program over here. File, new file. This is your script mode. We can write the program over here. So this is how we can write the program in Python. Now, what I need to do, I want to apply the if, like the basic construct of the programming, like I want to apply the conditional statement over there. Remember, in Python, it's not necessary to declare the variables. In Python, it's not necessary to declare the variable. It's not required. Like if I'm going to use A is equal to 90 and I am writing print type of A, it's by default, it belongs to integer. Suppose I'm writing A is equal to 89.45 and I'm writing print type of A. By default, it's a float. Suppose I'm writing A is equal to Santosh. Print A. By default, it's I am writing print type of A. by default is str. So we don't need to bother about the data types and all. According to the value, it will automatically get converted into that data type. So we don't need to think about that. What will be the data type and all. Now what I need to do, I need to write the program. So I'm just going to open the file. The file was a.py. I'm just going to open this. Now what I need to do, I need to apply the if statement over there. So how we can do that? I'm just writing if c less than 100. Then what we need to do? Remember, like in C, C++, Java, .NET, what we can use? We can use the braces over there. Braces means what? Braces means what? This is the body. This is the body for the if. Again, we can use like this. This means what? This is the body. Like in C, C++, Java, we are having the concept of braces over there. But in Python, we don't have the concept of braces. In Python, the important thing is indentation. Indentation is the important thing. Spacing. Always that we need to take care. Like I am writing if c less than 100. Now, in the next line, I need to write the code. For the next line, I'm just going to use colon. I'm just going to use the colon. Now, the important thing is, I need to write from this position only. I cannot change the cursor like this and this. No. After the colon, we need to write the from this position only. I am writing print c less than 100. Again, I need to apply the else. I'm just going to use else. And again colon. And again I need to write print c greater than 100. So that's it. This is your if statement. So in Python, that we need to always take care. Like indentation is the important thing. I'm going to run this. Number. We are getting c greater than 100. Again, I'm going to run this. We are getting c less than 100. So what I'm trying to say, the indentation is the most important thing in the Python. Suppose you are going to make the wrong indentation over there. You are just giving the path space like this. Space like this. Run this.
Oh, how do you run this script?
Expected an indentation block. We are getting the message over there. So the good thing about the Python is always we need to follow the spacing over there. Indentation. And how we can follow that? We don't need to fix it manually like this. It's not like that. The good thing is that, like I'm using if, I'm just giving colon, enter. Now, every time we need to write from this position only. Like else I'm writing, colon. Now I need to write from this position only. This is the important thing that we need to take care in the Python. Suppose I'm going to use if c less than 100. Then I'm going to write print c less than 100. Again, I'm going to use elif c less greater than 100 and c less than 200. Then what we need to do, I'm writing print c greater than 200, less than 200. Again, we can use else print c greater than 200. So this is how we can use else if over there. For the else if, we need to use the elif. Run this. Yeah, we are getting the output. So what I'm trying to say, like this is how we can use the if statement. This is how we can use the elif statement. Suppose I need to use the for loop. How we can use the for loop over there? suppose I need to apply the for loop. I'm just going to use for I in. Now I'm going to use the range function over there, range. Suppose I'm going to give the range 5, print I. Run this. See what value we are getting. We are getting 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Range by default start from the 0. So 0 to 4. If I'm going to use for I in range and I'm going to use 1 comma 5. So it will get a start from, it will get a start from 1, print I. I'm just going to make it comment or leave it. See, we are getting the value 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. That was the first for loop. And this is your second for loop, 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is how we can apply the range over there. Suppose I'm writing.
What are you pressing to run the program?
F5.
Oh, F5? Okay.
Yeah, this F5. Okay. Suppose I'm writing for I in a range. Suppose I need to display the table of 5. I need to display the table of 5. How we can display that? I am writing for I in range. I am just going to start the range from the 5, comma. It will go up to the 50. So always it takes minus 1. So I am going to start with the 5, 51. And now I need to give the step. Means I am just going to give 5. So initial value will be 5, after the 5 it will be the 10, after that it will be the 15, colon, print I, run this. See, we are getting 5, 10, 15, 20, 20, 35, 50. So this is how we can get the table of 5. Suppose I am going to give, I want to display the number in reverse order. I am writing for I in range from 10 comma 1 and I am just going to give minus 1. Run this. We are getting 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 3, 2. So this is how we can apply the for loop. Every time when we will go for the for loop, we need to use the range function over there. If I'm going to use 5, 5 means what? If I'm going to use the 5 over there, 5 means what? We are talking from 0 to 4. If I'm going to use 1 comma 5, 1 comma 5 means what? 1 to 4. If I'm going to use this one, means what? It starts from the 5, 5, 10, 15, like this, up to 50. And here, this is how we can use the loop in the reverse order, like 10, 9, 8, like this. So this is how we can use the for loop. This is how we can use the if statement. Now, again, what I need to do, I'm just going to make it comment. How we can make the comment over there? Like, I need to put the group comment. For the group comment, we can use single quotation. For the group comment, what we can use the single quotation over there for the group comment. Or in the place of single quotation, we can also use double quotation. We can also use the double quotation over there. Three times double quotation. This is again the group comment. Okay, now what I need to do, again I'm going to use for I in range 1 comma 10, 1 comma 5, and I'm going to use print I. And finally, even with the for loop, I'm going to apply the else print thanks. So if I'm going to run this, see, we are getting 1, 2, 3, 4, and finally we are getting thanks. So the new thing is there, like even with the for loop, we can apply the else statement over there. we can also apply the else statement. The else statement will get executed at last after the completion of this for loop. So again, that we need to take care. Other than this for loop, we are having the while loop over there. So I'm just going to use while. See, I'm just going to use like, I need to display the things 5 times. I'm just going to use while I less than equal to 5. I'm writing while I less than equal to 5 colon. Now what I'm going to use, I is equal to I plus 1, print I, run this. Name I is not defined. Here the thing is that we are using the I variables over there. I need to declare the value I initially. I'm just going to use I is equal to 0. Run this. See, we are getting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 because we are using less than equal to. So this is how we can apply the while loop. Even with the while loop, you can apply the else statement over there. Even with the while loop, we can apply the else statement over there. Like I'm writing while I less than equal to 10, I is equal to, now finally I'm going to use else statement over there. Else print welcome. Run this. And we are getting welcome. So what I'm trying to say, this is how we can apply the while statement. Even with the while statement, we can apply the else. This is how we can apply the for loop. Even with the for, we can apply the else statement over there. This is how we can apply the if statement. This is how we can apply the if statement. So these things we need to take care. Like again, I'm going to uncomment this. Suppose, like in normal programming languages, I'm going to use for I in a range. I'm going to use 1 to 10 colon. I'm going to use print I. But I don't want to display the 5 over there. So what I'm going to do is, if I is equal to 5, then what I'm writing over there, continue. Continue means what? It will just skip from that position. That it will not go for the print of 5. It will just, your loop will get continue. See, we are getting 1, 2, 3, 4, but we are not getting 5. Why? Because we are using the continue. Continue means what? Skip. You are skipping from that particular values. Further, it will not continue with this print. The loop will get executed next. In the place of continue, what we can do, like we can use the for loop with the, like I'm just going to use, if I is equal to 5, we can use the break. Break means the exit from the loop. Exit from the loop. If I'm going to use this, see, we are getting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is not there, 10 is there. Now we are getting 1, 2, 3, 4. But after 4, it gets exit from the loop. So we can apply the break. We can apply the continue. This is how we can apply the while statement. This is how we can apply the for loop. This is how we can apply the if statement. Now, by the use of these for loop, while loop and all, what we can do, now we can write the basic programs over there. Like this, these are the programs like how to enter the number, how to display the number, how to apply the if statement. These are the basic statements that we can apply. Suppose my question is, I'm just going to make it comment. Suppose my question is, enter a number. And what you need to do, you just need to display the number of digit of that number. This is the question. My question is, you need to enter a number and display the number of digit of that number. also, if I'm going to give like n, I'm going to give n is 4, 5, 6. What will be the output? It's 3. If I'm going to use n is equal to 7, 8, 6, 9, what will be the output? Output will be 4. So this is the question I need to do. Yeah, how we can do this? Yes, how we can do this? My question is, you need to enter a number, display the number of digit of that number. See, normally, the complete programming is based on the logic. The complete programs is based on the logic. And when we are talking about the logic, in any programming language, we need to consider the logic on the basis of like some program will be there that will be based on the number. So all the logic related with the numeric, some numeric logic is required for string handling, some logic is required for the array handling, some logic is required. Mainly the complete logic is based on these three things. And what I'm trying to say, like in the number and all, we are having the certain logic that we need to consider. It's around 10 to 15 logics is there. If we will get familiar with all these logics, every program will be based on only these logics. The same thing with the string. It's around 10 logic is there. If we can find it, it's not 10. It's around 5 logic is there. It's again based on the array. It's around 5 logic is there. So the important thing regarding the programming is always we need to try to build the logic. And the logic is based on the certain things. Like different logic is there, just we need to focus on these logics. On the basis of these logic, what we can do, we can write any programs over there. So my question is, you need to enter a number and display the number of digit of that number. Okay, from the beginning, I'm going to start with this program, how we can do this. What I need to do, I need to enter the number. First of all, that we need to consider about the programming and all. Like what is the input and what will be the output? The input is you need to enter the number and the output should be number of digit. If I'm going to enter 4, 5, 6, the number of digit will be 3. That I need to take care. So how we can do this? The simple logic will be, it's a traditional logic, traditional kind of thing is there. What we can do, we can divide the number by 10, like 4, 5, 6. If I'm going to divide the number by the 10, so initially the 6 will get removed. Again, the 5 will get removed and finally the 4 will get removed. So we need to divide the number up to 0. So, okay, I'm just going to write the program. N is equal to. Int. N is equal to int, input, enter number. Now what we need to do, I'm going to enter the number. I'm just going to apply the while loop because we need to divide the number up to 0. So I'm just writing while n not equals to 0. I'm just writing while n not equals to 0. And what I'm going to do, I'm just going to use n is equal to n divided by 10. Remember, in Python, for the divide, we are having the two operators. If I'm going to write print 5 divided by 2, we will get 2.5. If I will write 5 divided by 2, we will get 2. It will remove the decimal values. So what I'm going to do, I'm just writing n is equal to n divided by 10. And I'm just using c is equal to c plus 1. C is equal to c plus 1. And I need to declare the variable c over there. So I'm just going to declare c is equal to 0. And finally, I'm going to print. The number of digit is number of digit is, comma, I'm going to display the C. Run the program. Enter number. I'm going to give 678. The number of digit is 3. Again, I need to program. Enter number. We are getting the number of digit is 4. So this is the simple logic for the program. Now what I need to do to understand any logic, we need to go for the dry run. Remember, in today's scenario, it's a genuine problem of the students that normally people feel that they don't have the logic. They are lacking for behind the logic. The problem is, always we try to write the program like this. Some books is there, some pages will be there, and just you copy the pages and all, you just make the paste and all, copy and paste. Or even you can copy from the books and all. We never do this. That's why the problem is there with the logic. So I'm just going to tell you like how to run this program without your machine. Suppose we don't have the system, we don't have the machine, and I need to execute this program, how we can do that? For that purpose, we are having the process called dry run. This is simple, the mathematical process that I need to follow. I'm going for the dry run. Dry run means what? Run without the machine. So I'm just going to dry run the programs. For any program, we need to go for the dry run. I'm just going for the dry run. Okay, step by step, do the things. The first line, enter number n is equal to. I'm going to give the number n is equal to 876. C is equal to 0, okay. While n not equals to 0, yes, n not equals to 0, n is equal to 876. Good. So we will be there in the loop. N is equal to n divided by 10. So the first time we are in the loop, n is equal to 876 divided by 10. It will be 87.6. It will remove the decimal values. So n will be 87. C is equal to C plus 1. What is the previous value of C? It's 0. 0 plus 1 means what? It's 1. Yeah. Again, the loop will get continue. While n not equals to 0, yes, n not equals to 0, n is equal to 87. Again, the loop will get continue. N is equal to n divided by 10. N is equal to, it will be 8. Again, C is equal to C plus 1. Previous value of C is 1. 1 plus 1 is equal to 2. Again, your loop will get continue because n not equals to 0. N is equal to 8. So again, what I'm going to do? N is equal to 0. Sorry. N is equal to n divided by 10. 8 divided by 10. N will be 0. And I'm getting C is equal to C plus 1. It's 2 plus 1, 3. And finally, the loop will get completed because it's a 0. The number of digits is C. So it's going to display your C. So this is how we need to do the dry run for every program. If we will follow this dry run every time, remember, the logic will get completed for you. For any program, if you are writing the program, just go for the dry run. You will get each and everything over there. You don't need to run the program with the machine. Even with the paper and pen, you can write the program and you can run the program. So this is how we can start this. It's clear? This is a simple program. Suppose what I'm going to do, I'm just going to do, my question is enter number. Check the number is even or odd. It's a simple program is there. I'm just going to run this. I'm writing n is equal to int input enter number. If n modulus 2 is equal to 0, then what we need to do? I'm writing print even number else. I'm writing print, it's an odd number. Run the program. Yeah, we are getting even number. Run this. It's the odd number. So these are the simple program that we can write over there and all. So now what you need to do, all these things are there in front of you. I'm just going to make it copy and send you the mail. At first, you need to go through these things. Like you need to get the familiar with all these things, like how to apply the if, how to apply the for, how to apply the while, how to apply the break, how to apply the continue. Write down these programs over there. And finally, I will give you some questions. That questions you need to solve. It's fine?
Yeah, that's fine. I just don't really understand the dry run. So is that just like practicing on our own in comments?
Yeah, exactly. It's based on the requirement. It's not based on the... See, basically, this particular portion is just how to build the logic.
Okay.
Like, yeah, I'm just giving you this. Okay, this is the solution for this program. Now, you need to understand how the solution exactly works. That you need to understand. How you can understand that. For that, what we need to do, this is the better way. Just go for the dry run. Dry run means what? Every line you are executing manually over there.
Okay.
Like n, input number, okay, n is this. C is equal to 0, okay, c is equal to this. While n not equals to 0, we are in the loop, yes. N is equal to n divided by 10. N is equal to 876 divided by 10, 87.6. Because double slashing we are using, so the value will be 87, okay. C is equal to c plus 1, okay, initial value of c is 0. C is equal to c plus 1, okay, the next value is 1. So for every program, you need to write the dry run. I will go with that.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'm just going to make it copy and paste and send you the mail. You just need to open the mail and initially just go through all these things. And after that, we will write some programs over there. It's fine. So the first thing, how to start with the Python and all. The first thing that you need to install. After the installation, what you need to write over there? IDLE. Here you need to write IDLE. It will start the Python. In the IDLE, we are having the two environment over there. One is immediate mode. And the second one is the skip mode. This one is your skip mode and this is your immediate mode. Immediate mode means what? Here you can directly run the things. Yeah, we are getting the output. And this is what? This is your skip mode. Here you can write the programs and all. How to run this program? F5. Or just click on this.